Hi everyone, welcome to Free Daily Bread. Don't forget to subscribe. We're going to get in Revelation chapter 14. Let's pray first. Heavenly Father, I pray that more people understand that you have an amazing redemption plan for Israel. And if people have a problem with that, they need to take that to the cross and repent immediately. There's not enough time. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, so chapter 14, Revelation. Let's read the first verse. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. First, let's discuss who this group is. It's obviously the same exact 144,000 in chapter 7. They got sealed before the wrath of God began, back in chapter 7. These are obviously 12,000 Jewish men from each literal 12 tribes of Israel. The bloodlines from each 12 tribes. Let me explain how you know someone is a Nazi and not a Christian. They will say the woman, which is Israel in chapter 12, they will say that's the church. And then they will also say that these 144,000 somehow make up for the top servants of the church. As if God has some sort of first fruits in the church. Okay, no. That is blasphemy, Nazi ideology. Okay, if you can't admit that this group is the first fruit of Jews redeemed, then you need to take the anti-Semitism to the cross and repent while you have time. Notice in verse 4, it says they're the first fruits. Look, it's just unbelievable how many hate the Jews and they think they're going to get to heaven. Also, Jehovah's Witnesses, the other Jewish haters get this into their cult teachings that there's only a limited number of 144,000 that will go to heaven, okay? Because that's what Nazis do. They have to change the word of God for their own beliefs. And their cult teachings constantly change. Like it's not even stable on who exactly they say the 144,000 will be. So in 1930, they claimed all the 144,000 were already sealed. Okay. And then everyone else who dies, they would go to sleep in the grave until judgment day. And then maybe they might get a second chance to repent somehow. And then they can join the millennial kingdom. Okay. Which they call paradise. Be aware of people who constantly refer to heaven as paradise. They may be a Jehovah's Witness or Muslim. Then so they said that in 1930, that they were all sealed. But then in 1935, just 5 years later, they of course decided, well, they want to be part of the group that goes to heaven. So their number changed to only 52,465 were sealed. Okay, there's plenty more that can be sealed. So somehow that happened. Somehow in 1935, dramatically, the numbers decreased. Then in 2005, they decreased again to only 8,524 were sealed and get to go to heaven. Really? That's odd. And then in 2020, it increased to now 21,182 Jehovah Witnesses get to go to heaven. All right, now you know what they say? Now the watchtower says the full amount of the 144,000, they will all be sealed only before the tribulation begins. Oh, really? Okay, so you see how they replace themselves with the Jews. That's called replacement theology. It's Nazi ideology. So let me explain what this cult, why this cult does this, why they keep changing it. First, they started by making the first Jehovah Witness believers thinking they were the 144,000. Okay? But after years, when new members wanted to be the 144,000, okay, that's what happened. So to bring in the new cult members, they have to pretend they have a chance to go to heaven. They also believe they will be the only ones to survive the tribulation. That's the belief now, because that, you see, they replaced themselves with these 144,000 Jews in chapter 14. But the thing about them, though, is they have no assurance of salvation, because it's a work-based religion. They claim to be sealed, but they claim that they may be sealed. Okay, that's the thing about them too. They don't believe the Holy Spirit is God. So they don't believe that they can be sealed until the day of redemption. They don't believe that the Holy Spirit is God. They think it's only an it, like a force. What is this, Star Wars? May the Force be with you. Okay. So they claim to be sealed prior to the tribulation, but they could still fail from not good enough works. Okay. That's why Jehovah Witnesses work so hard trying to recruit in public and even knocking on doors, because if they don't, then they won't be the 144,000 who get to go to heaven, and neither will they enjoy paradise on earth. It's a works-based salvation. Understand, when you come to the cross, it's none of your own works, nothing, none of your Bible reading, none of your church service, okay, none of that. It's only your faith when you come to the cross. But after the cross, when you receive salvation, you better believe good works are going to come. But do you initially receive salvation from your good works? Absolutely not. You see, the death of what Jesus did for us is not enough for religions. Just like how Catholics don't think the blood of Jesus was enough for atonement. So they must take the Eucharist every week for their atonement. So nowhere does it say only in the Bible that only 144,000 people go to heaven. That's ridiculous. Scripture says what, Christians? Present with the body. I'm sorry. Absent with the body is present with the Lord. But as far as this first harvest of Jewish believers, it is a little mystery going on here. All right, let's get away from Jehovah Witness stuff, seriously. So let's get on to this. This is a little bit of a mystery on what's going on here. So let me explain this. Because this is the first harvest, all right? There are many other Jews who God protected during the tribulation and will be brought into the millennial kingdom. But only these 144,000 are now with Jesus on Mount Zion. So the questions, here's the questions before we start reading. Here's the questions. Is this a heavenly Mount Zion in heaven? Or is this a Mount Zion on earth? The other questions. Is this before the second coming of Christ? Or after the second coming of Christ? Other questions. If they are in heaven, how did they get there? Were they killed? Because if so, did God seal them with protection for just a limited time like the two witnesses? Or did they get to heaven in some sort of miraculous way? Kind of like their own gathering to heaven in the latter part of the tribulation? Kind of like Enoch walking, then when he was with God. Here's my answer to almost every question I just asked, church. Look, I don't know. I don't know many of these questions, answers. This is another chapter, just like chapter 10 with the little scroll, that we don't know it all. This is another chapter to keep us humble. So all we can do is just read and try to figure out as much as we can. But we know for a fact that these are 144,000 Jewish men, they got sealed. They belong to the 12 tribes of Israel. We know that for a fact. This is not the church. So let's talk about Mount Zion. What we know is Mount Zion is a literal hill in Jerusalem where the temple is. Okay, Mount Zion is also referred to God's dwelling place in heaven. Look at Psalms 48, verse 2. Beautiful for situation. That word means elevation. The joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. When it says the sides of the north, that means God's dwelling place. Okay. Hold on a second. Mount Zion is also understood as a place of transformation in the heart, in the human heart. Look at Hebrews 12, verse 22. But you are come unto, look, you have come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God in heavenly Jerusalem, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable company of angels. So isn't that interesting? There is a heavenly Jerusalem, just like an earthly Jerusalem. There's a heavenly Jerusalem. That's amazing. So when scripture says, Christians, when scripture says in Ephesians 2 verse 6 that we are seated in high places already, you know what that means? That means our heart is now set on our new residence in heaven, although we are not there yet. So Zion is simply Jerusalem, people, the city of God, the city that God loves. And yes, there's a heavenly Jerusalem and there's an earthly Jerusalem. The word Zion occurs in the Bible 150 times. Zion means fortification. All right, stay with me now. This is interesting. Fortification and has the idea of being raised up, all right, like a monument. So it's interesting in verse 4, John refers to the first fruit as the 144,000. The first fruit. Where does it say that? All right. Being the first fruits for God. Okay. Stay with me. This is interesting. He refers to his first 144,000 Jewish end time believers as his first fruit because the high priest would have the first fruit of the harvest in the air for an offering to God. Look at Leviticus 23, verse 9. All right, 23 verse 9. Hold on. 9 to 12. This is about the first fruits. This is basically, this is a Jewish feast. Okay, this is when, that's when it will be fulfilled. The first fruits is going to be fulfilled when the 144,000 are in heaven or on the earthly Mount Zion. Just stay with me now. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when you come into the land which I give unto you, you shall reap the harvest thereof, when you shall bring a sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest to the priest. And he shall wave the sheaf before the Lord to be accepted for you on the morrow, that means tomorrow, after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. After the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. The seventh day, okay, of rest, that symbolizes the millennial kingdom. Okay, so this is going to be fulfilled during the millennial kingdom, it appears. But that's quite amazing. Stay with me now. This is amazing. So now, here we have the male lamb, because in Leviticus it said it needed a male lamb. That is Jesus, who is also our high priest. They also need a priest. So here we have the Lamb and the high priest in one. That is Jesus, with his first fruit of Jews on a hill as a symbol of in the air. They have to wave it in the air. That's amazing. They are an offering before God. Okay, the first fruits are an offering before God. They spiritually gave themselves to serve Christ, and they bring it's like they being the first means there also means that means there's a whole harvest coming in too. They're only the first of the Jewish believers. There's many more coming. Okay? So that's amazing. A large Jewish remnant of believers will be collected when Jesus returns. Look in verse 14. This is the second coming of Christ. Okay, he's referred to as having a sickle, a sharp sickle. When do you ever see pictures of Jesus with a sharp sickle in his hand? Anyways, this is a gathering. This is a reap gathering. And then there's another angel that comes with a sickle. The sickle that Jesus has, he's collecting his fruitful harvest. Okay, so he has the first fruits already, but now he's coming for the rest. Jewish believers. Okay, the whole Revelation is all about the Jews. Okay, so you need to get the church out of your head, because number one, the church is not here. This is all about Israel. So that's amazing. In verse 14, that's Jesus collecting the rest of his harvest. Yes, there may be some Christians that have survived. Gentiles, not many will survive, I bet. Not many. It's going to be mainly Jewish believers that he protected during the tribulation. Okay. Not many tribulation saints will survive all the way to the end. Only the believing Jews will be protected. So, look, if you have a problem with that, then shame on you. Shame on you, okay? Just like the church is the bride that God took to protect prior to the rapture, God protects the new believing Jews during the tribulation, because he is also mentioned as their husband. Look at Isaiah 54, verse 5. For your maker is your husband, talking to Israel. The Lord of hosts is his name, and your Redeemer, this is Jesus, the Holy One of Israel, the God of the whole earth, shall he be called. Israel has a husband. Jesus Christ. Understand, the church has only been engrafted to Israel's promises. Israel is also the wife. Okay, but the tribulation saints are killed in God's wrath because they are not the church. They are not the bride. Okay, they are what you can call invites to the wedding. Okay, so that's why all believing Jews are protected during the tribulation, because the husband protects his wife. And that's why God protects the new believing Jews. The church has been engrafted to their promises. So again, how these 144,000 got to this Mount Zion, okay? And if it's in heaven or on earth, I'm not sure. But let's just keep reading. Because in verse 3, it does say they were redeemed from the earth, all right? So does that mean the end time gathering on earth at the end of the tribulation? Or were they gathered in heaven? So again, let's just keep reading. Verse 2. And I heard a voice from heaven as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder, and I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. In verse 2, notice it says, he hears this from heaven. So here we go. I believe it's safe to now say that they are in heaven. Okay? I believe this voice of many waters is God with the voice of thunder that was mentioned in 1 verse 4, 15 and 4 verse 5. So perhaps God proclaims his approval of the first harvest offering, like in Matthew 25, 21, saying, "Well done, good and faithful servants." We know the 24 elders in chapter 5, verse 8 had harps. Or maybe these 144,000 now have harps, okay? Whatever the case, this worship service is accompanied with music. Verse 3. And they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man can learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. Redeemed from the earth, gathered, rescued from the earth. They must be in heaven right now, okay? So the 144,000 Jewish servants of God sing a song only they know. Whatever the words are, no one else no one else could thank God for what they are thanking him for. That's why these are their own words, okay, their own song. He is the promise, okay, they are the promise to Abraham, the first of the end time mass collection of Jews who will reign forever. Also interesting that if they are in heaven, okay, which I believe, well, they must have glorified bodies, I assume, okay? If so, when they are assigned their lots, let me show this, okay? Let me just put it sideways. I'm sure you can still read it without me changing the camera. This is the lots of the millennial kingdom. When I say the lots, I mean their portions, their territories of where they will be assigned. So if these 144,000 have glorified new bodies, I assume they may. If so, when they are assigned to their lots, then that means these 144,000 will be in glorified bodies among the rest of the Jews who survived the tribulation. Okay. Also, of course, the Old Testament saints. All right, the Old Testament saints, they now have glorified bodies. You see, they're also waiting for the rapture for a new body. You ever think about that? We want glorified new bodies, but you ever think about those in heaven waiting for their new glorified body? So you see, God promised Abraham he would have more descendants than the stars, all right? Understand the majority of survivors at the end of the tribulation, okay, and believe are mainly all Jews, okay, an average of 5 million of them. So the vast majority of all the survivors that go into the God's winepress of the wrath, well, they'll go to hell. The vast majority are going to hell at the end of the tribulation. So it's mainly the Jews that will repopulate the world. So the most persecuted group on the earth right now, since the beginning of time, will one day be the most thriving. That's amazing. That's why Nazis hate God's plan, but yet still proclaim to be a Christian. Okay, so what it is they want heaven, but they don't want any Jews there. Well, okay. They're going to find themselves right next to Hitler. If you have a problem with the fact the millennial kingdom will have an astounding number of Jews, then you won't be there, period. God picked Israel as an example of his mercy, to show his holiness, okay? For an example to show his character and how he judges. And his discipline on the ones that he loves will be well noticed during the millennial kingdom. Look at Zechariah 8:23. Thus says the Lord of hosts, in those days, what days? The millennial kingdom. It shall come to pass that 10 men shall take hold of all languages of the nations. These are Gentiles that are in the millennial kingdom. He says 10 Gentiles are going to come, look, and shall take hold of the skirt of him. Who's him? The Jew. That is a Jew. Look, it says that is a Jew. Saying, and this is what they're going to say, we will go with you, for we have heard that God is with you. Gentiles will honor the Jews and give them a high respect during the millennial kingdom because they know they're God's chosen people. Period. Period. The Jews will be favored, okay, and highly respected as God's chosen ones. And that's why no Nazi replacement theology will God tolerate in his presence. God will in fact redeem Israel, and these redeemed, okay, it says they were redeemed in verse 3, were only the first of the Jewish harvest that would still be collected at his second coming. Look at Matthew 24, 31. So many think 24 is for the church. No, this is for the Jews. The rapture happened. Okay, this is during the tribulation. But here's at the end in 24 verse 31. Many think those who teach replacement theology will say that this is the church being collected. No, it's not. This is the Jews, the believing Jews at the end of the tribulation being collected. When the Son of Man comes, he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet. What's this trumpet? This is the Jewish Feast of Trumpets. This is when it will be fulfilled. And they shall gather together his elect. Who's his elect? The Jews. The believing Jews from the four winds from all over the world. Tribulation Jews. Amen. Why I sound so stern and serious and raw is because I cannot believe the amount of so-called Christians who say God is done with Israel. It is beyond, it's insane. It's insane. So, the whole point of the tribulation is to redeem Israel. News alert. The church was, look. The church has been redeemed for the last 2,000 years. God forbid if 7 years of Jews get redeemed in the end. People hate that there will be a last generation of many believing Jews. They hate it. It should be a true Christian's prayer every night to say this, Lord, come and get your bride so you can finish your redemption plan with the Jews. Verse 4, these are they which were not defiled with woman, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God into the Lamb. Amen. Amen. Notice these 144,000 men were virgins, all right, which means they were never married and probably young. I'm guessing late teens or in their 20s. The Jews are very serious on waiting till marriage, even this day. It's only pagan Gentiles that have no respect for their bodies. Praise God, he is very forgiving. But repentance must come. Understand, no fornicator will enter the kingdom of heaven, period. Many will say these are the church. Okay, the first fruits is the church. No. Nope. Many will say, yeah, these are the church, and it only means the church was pure. Wrong. All right, so when it says they are virgins, they don't take this as 144,000 literal men that are literally virgins. They will say this just means the church was pure. Okay. No. These are 144,000 literal Jewish virgins. You see, Paul was single for his servitude for God. And God told Jeremiah he wouldn't marry because of the wrath coming to Israel. See Jeremiah 16, verse 2. And these 144,000 followed the Lamb because they were redeemed. Amen. These 144,000 received salvation no different than anyone else through our faith and God's grace. But how did these unbelieving Jews get such quick insight after the rapture that Jesus was their king? Let me show you. Look at Romans 11, 25. Replacement theology people would have to take Romans chapter 11 and throw it out the window. 11:25 Look, he says, I don't want you to be ignorant. Amen, Paul. Don't be ignorant to this, that you should be wise in your own conceits. Don't be conceited. That, look, blindness in part has happened to Israel. Blindness, a spiritual blindness. Until when? The fullness of the Gentiles. At the rapture of the church is the fullness of the Gentiles, and then the blinder of the Jews comes off. Amen. When the number of Gentiles come in, wow. Imagine being that very last Gentile giving your life to the Lord, and then you find yourself in the clouds. Talk about cutting it close. So that's when the rapture will happen, when that very last Gentile is saved. Wow, I can't wait to meet that person. Like, yo, that was close, dude. So when that happens, then immediately the blinder is off the Jews. Understand? So this is what I think. I believe the second after the rapture, I believe Jesus came to each of these 144,000, not much different than Saul going to Damascus, a miracle sighting of Jesus, and he's assigning them their mission, a clear vision. You can say they are it's almost like a godly nucleus of Israel, okay? Their end time evangelism in Israel about Jesus is what will bring many other believing Jews in to the harvest. I'm sure Gentiles also will hear the words of these end time evangelists, but they're going to be in Israel. It's all about Israel. So many arrogant will say, well, how is anyone going to get saved with the church gone? How are they going to hear the gospel? Well, guess what? God don't need the church to finish the job. The Jews will do it. The Jews were the first one to give the gospel, and guess what? They're going to be the last. Besides, if you're worried about end time evangelism, well, then start now. Also, my next teaching, we learn about a heavenly angel who delivers to everyone the gospel. Everyone. Everyone. And people say, people will say, I hear this. Oh, there's going to be some Christians left behind because God needs them to give the gospel during the tribulation. Whoa, 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 whoa. That's dangerous. That pride is unbelievable. Imagine this. How much you want to bet when some miss the rapture for the only reason of fraudulent faith, some will continue the act of being sincere by telling people, well, I was only left behind because I'm so special and God needed me to share the gospel. Really? Really? So it's like they take their pride and they extend it into the tribulation, and that pride isn't going to get saved either. Let me say this slow and clear. If you miss the rapture, it was only for one reason. You didn't have a saving faith. How dangerous for some who will take their pride, yeah, and extend that into the tribulation as some sort of anointed messenger. Wow. Verse 5. And in their mouth was found no guile, that means lie, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Amen. Unlike people who lie about their faith, these 144,000 didn't lie. You see, that's what happens when you're redeemed. You speak truth, and when you love God, well, you obey God. These 144,000 are not sinless, okay? It's just that after meeting Jesus, well, they now lived holy. And because of that, they are without fault before God. Look at Ephesians 5:27. This is about sanctification, being washed by the word, which is a good look. Sanctifying means you become holier and holier, more Christ-like. And you can't do that without the word of God. Okay, look, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having a spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be a holy and without blemish. Do you have spots and wrinkles? Are you not holy? And are you living in willful sin is the question. Because if so, you're not going to heaven. I'm just reading the Bible. So many so-called Christians say you can live in willful sin. Really? He's coming for a spotless bride. That's like saying this. Listen. Oh, I'm married to my husband and I love him. Look, but you know, I only cheat once a week. I love my husband. It's only once a week I cheat on him. News alert. If you love your husband, well, you will be faithful to your husband. That's the same with God. If you say you love God, but you do things on purpose that offend him, look at 1 John 2:4. Well, he that says, I know him and keeps not his commandments is a liar and the truth is not in him. Okay. Look in 3:6. Whoever abides in him sins not. Whoever sins has not seen him, neither knows him. If you're living in willful sin, you don't know God. You've never seen him. He that commits sin, look, do not be deceived. He that commits sin is of the devil. Verse 9, whoever is born of God does not commit sin. For his seed, that means the gospel remains in him. He cannot sin because he's born of God. He's born again. And how do you know the manifestation of children of God compared to children of the devil? Well, obedience. And their love. Love for God comes with obedience. Again, people don't know the difference between a willful sin and an accidental sin. They really don't. They think it's the same thing. Listen, a willful sin is this. I got $20 in my pocket. I'm going to go down to the store and I'm going to get me a case of beer and I'm going to get drunk. That's a willful sin. That's planned. I know God don't like it, but I'm going to do it anyways. That's not the life of a Christian. Accidental sin. I use this for an example. If you stub your toe and you accidentally cuss, okay, that was not planned. It just happened. And that also grieves the true Christian, and you're going to ask for forgiveness immediately. Even a accidental sin grieves the true Christian. How much more would a willful sin? Whew. Sorry, just thinking. It's just so grieving. Look in 5:18 in 1 John. 5:18. We know that whoever is born of God sins not. But he that is begotten of God, that means born again, all right, keeps himself, and that wicked one touches him not. Keeps himself from what? From temptation. Okay? We know we are of God. How do you know that you are of God? Your obedience to him in the whole world lies in wickedness. Well, ain't that right? Ain't that right? When you're born again, something amazing happens. You receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit power gives the true Christian, okay, power to say no to temptation. His love, it's like it rules you, okay? You now are in obedience to God. You're either mastered by sin or you're mastered to righteousness. Go back to 1 John. Yeah, John didn't play when it came to sin. Look in 5, go back to 5 verse 2. 5 verse 2. By this we know that we love the children of God. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. How do you know that you love God? You keep his commandments. Obedience is love. So how do you know you really don't love God? You can live in willful sin. If you got a problem with that, you need to go to the cross. You need to repent, and you need to stop playing games. These 144,000, they stopped playing games as soon as they met Jesus. So should the Christian. Period. Do you love God? That's the first commandment, to love him more than anyone and anything. Or do you love your sin more? If you love God more than you have a, if you love God more than you have a gratitude to obey God. We obey God not out of fear from going to hell. We obey God because we love him and we have a gratitude for what he did for us. Those who really don't have a gratitude, they don't care. They can go, they say that God's grace is a license to sin. They are wrong. God's grace for the one that's not converted is only his patience waiting for them to repent. That has an expiration date. The grace for the convert teaches holy living. Jesus is coming for a spotless bride, not a dirty harlot. Yes, God cleanses us, but we must remain that way. We don't go back to eat old vomit and play in the mud. I was an alcoholic. You think I'm going to be in the bar tomorrow night? No. Okay, repent. How do you know you have a relationship with God? Well, just like these 144,000, you now live to serve Christ. It's no longer about yourself. Your flesh has been crucified on that cross. And when you serve Christ, well, you obey Christ. If you follow the Lamb, like in verse 4, they follow the Lamb, that's the shepherd, then you won't be following your flesh. That's exactly what they did. Let's pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, you have a beautiful redemption plan for your chosen people. How dare people claim you are their Lord, but they're against your redemption plan for Israel? No Jew hater of any sort will dwell in your presence. Matter of fact, we shouldn't be against any race receiving redemption. All nations will reign with you, including Israel. You don't save us in Israel because we deserved it. You save us because you're merciful. You use Israel to show that you keep your word. And we pray you come for your church, Lord, so that this will be the people group of Jews today who know you are their king. In Jesus' name, amen.